drinking dark whiskey, telling white lies. One leads to another on a Saturday night. Don't you cross your heart and let your hope to die. Drinking dark whiskey, telling white lies.
Welcome back to Behind the Label. Today we're opening up the proverbial can of worms with the Beam family.
It's complicated. It's kind of like an Eastern Kentucky, you know, family tree. We've got this board up here to keep us straight.
Yeah.
And this is only about half. You know, this segment is going to be so big that we have to break it down into two different sittings. Because usually when we film these, we film like about an hour's worth. We'll film like four episodes at once. And we'll have four or five things to drink like this, four or five bourbons or ryes. But with the beans, there's no way we can do it in one sitting.
Yeah, there's no way we can do it all on one board, and there's no way we can drink
it all, and, it would be too long because we'd be here 2.5 hours. So today, we're actually at Limestone Branch.
And we'll have, actually on the front of this video, I'll tag up our little teaser, and you'll be able to see the outside. We got some photos, I'll tack those up. If you're looking for a really great craft experience, that it's also tied in with the major families, the Beams, this is ideal.
We're
just outside Lebanon, Kentucky, and they've been gracious enough, Stephen Beam has been gracious enough to allow us to film here. So we're actually out on their outdoor patio section and getting ready to get our hands warmed up and open this up.
Yeah, we'll be warmed up with these. So we're enjoying that. We're grateful that Stephen, you know, allowed us to come out here and do this. So a little bit later, we're going to go in and take a tour, and we'll actually interview Stephen now to be part of this this segment, the series that we're doing on the Beams. I don't know, Lowell, we go back quite a while to start with the Beams.
We do.
How many generations are they?
I want to say 8 or 9, right?
Seven. Getting close to 8. I mean.
Well, that's right, because you were telling me that Freddie.
Freddie is actually starting. The 8th generation is kind of starting working with his dad, Fred.
8 generations is a long way.
It is. It's a very long way. So, of course, when we go back that far, how far are we going back to?
Pre-Revolutionary War. I'm thinking a three-cornered hat is coming out of that bag.
Yeah. How'd you guess?
So on some of the other families.
It's hard to tell which direction a three-cornered hat goes.
I didn't think there would even be. Well, I guess, yeah, because your head isn't completely.
It's a triangle. I mean, you know, you can put it on any direction. It's equal on all sides.
Well, it looks equally great on you and any from any angle.
Yeah. So we go back into the late 1700s, and we started our talk with about the name Johannes Jacob Bohm.
Sounds German to me.
It is German. They were German immigrants. You know, his ancestors were. He was actually raised in Maryland. So it actually gets shortened to Jacob Beam. You know, they take out all the extra German sounding part of it, and it's actually Jacob Beam. He was kind of young in Maryland. His mom and dad had 13 kids. He was one of 13. His dad, Nicholas, died when he was young. Nicholas was only 29 when he passed away. So his mom.
Now, was he originally actually born in Germany or?
No, he was born in Maryland. And his mom took the clan and went back to her brother's farm. Her brothers were Jost and Jacob Myers. So they went and stayed with them in Maryland.
This is still
so
Maryland.
That's where Jacob Beam actually grew up, was in Maryland. And he developed a real good friendship with Jacob Myers. So we have to keep the Jacob separated. Jacob Myers, Jacob Beam. His uncle, who was younger, Josh was like older, Jacob was a lot younger. They developed a friendship with each other. And they actually, when they got older, Jacob was just a little bit older, Jacob Myers a little bit older than Jacob Beam. And when they got old enough, they actually started distilling together in Maryland.
But now this was, I guess at that time it would just be rye whiskey.
It would have been rye, yes. Rye was real big in Maryland, Pennsylvania. Right. So they teamed up and were distilling in Maryland. You're talking about then, you know, the late, early 1780s, like that. And actually.
Now this would be not a commercial distillery.
Smaller distillery. But Jacob Myers actually left and came up the Wilderness Trail. So he moved into Kentucky. He was actually going there to secure some land for his older brother, Joss. And he got like 800 acres that they were going to get
on the Wilderness Trail. Was it a royal decree or something? Or like, was it one of those, like, you know,
I'm not for sure exactly how he got the, you know, the land. Joss.
This was after the Revolutionary War.
So it could have been a grant.
It could have been land grant.
Yeah, because back then you were, if you could do 40 acres, you know, of corn and put a house on it, you could get 400 acres. You know, could buy it, or you could buy more. So I would say Joss probably purchased 800 acres. So Jacob actually moved here. And actually in the late 1780s, Jacob Meyer set up a distillery on the Dixie River down in Lincoln County.
Yeah.
So he was actually considered one of the earliest distillers in the state, Jacob Meyer.
And that's a commercial distillery.
That was a bigger distillery, yes, down on the river. So once Jacob Bean got a little older, he got married, had kids, and he actually came into Kentucky in the late 1780s. When he arrived, he stayed with his uncle on the property there for a little while.
In Lincoln County.
In Lincoln County, yes. So he stayed with him for a while. One thing about it is Joss Meyer actually passed away before he ever saw Kentucky. So he never got to see the land that his brother had secured. So Jacob Bean actually moves, you know, there with his uncle. Like I said, that's, you know, two distilling legends kind of in Kentucky were there. Eventually, as he gets older, he moves on into Washington County. Takes the family and moves to Washington County. And by 1795, Jacob, now everybody looking at this, if you can read this, this is only half of the tree, and it's not, probably not even half, probably more like a fourth of the family tree. So we start with Jacob up here, and he started distilling in Kentucky in 1795. So not one of the first, because there were a few that were in the 1780s, but he became very prominent in the late 1790s. For how good a distiller he was.
Now, what was his distiller, what was it called at that time? Was it just called the Jacob Bean Distillery?
Yeah, it would have been a small farm distillery.
Okay. But it wasn't branded, marketed? And
not at that time,
okay.
No.
Okay.
Not when he first started. They didn't come along until a little later. Jacob had a son, David, who kind of took over the distillery in the 1820s. And ran the distillery for quite a while until he passed away in 1852. So that's the easy part of the Beans line. You got one to two. You know, they worked together, and David, you know, had three sons. So this is where we start getting complicated.
Yeah, start getting branched out.
It is. And so the, you know, first two generations, straight down, they both worked together on this distillery in Washington.
Washington.
Yes. So David has three sons. He has Joseph, who's the oldest. He has David M., the middle child. And then he has John Henry, or Jack.
Yeah.
So today, we're going to kind of concentrate on Joseph, the line from Joseph. But in order to do that, we actually have to move back over to this side, to the David M. side.
It is a little Eastern Kentucky.
It is very Eastern Kentucky, because the Beans,
in Marion.
When you talk about the Beans, they were in every large distillery in the state almost. I mean, they were distillers in every distillery you can think of. When we get to Joseph L. Bean and talk about his kids, you'll kind of see that. So, one other interesting point too about Jacob Bean was his older brother, Conrad Bean, had secured land beside Jacob Meyer's also on the Wilderness Trail. So the family had already moved in, even, you know, his brothers had already moved in before he did. So now we're down to the third generation, and at that time, all three of these sons of David worked at that distillery.
In Washington County?
Yes.
In Lincoln County?
Yeah. Washington.
Washington, okay,
yeah,
that's right, they had moved from Lincoln County
to Washington. Yeah. So all three of them started at that distillery, and about that time is when they came out with the first brand. Old Tub. It sounds like an inviting name.
It sounds like old bathtubs, but yeah. It even has on the label, if you get one of these, or actually I'll throw a picture up on it, there's actually an upside down old wash tub on there.
Yeah.
So I don't think they were saying that they made it in a wash tub, but it probably wasn't far from that.
Yeah, they were very concerned about marketing back then in the name. But that was their first brand, and what we're drinking today, have you had any of it?
I have not.
Let's
give it a try. So
It's still made by Jim Beam.
This is out of the Claremont.
Yes, facility, right? Yeah. So it honors their legacy of the founders of the beans. So this is a 4-year 100 proof bottle and bond bourbon. So this is go back quite a while for this. Quite a ways.
Now is this is the same recipe and same mash bill and everything from that far back?
Probably not, but. Probably the same mash bill that Jim Beam started after Prohibition.
Okay.
Yeah, kind of come up with his mash bill. So, but this is history right here, old tub. So this is where it started.
Got a drunk fruit fly in mind.
Did you? Well, he's pretty happy.
He's a happy fruit fly.
Yes.
No, this is pretty good. For me, I'm still trying to kind of get used to that heat.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know the mash bill on this?
Not on that one. I'll look it up though.
All right.
We'll be ready for our next episode. We'll talk about it.
So. Oh, like it. That's 4 year old. So it's a good bourbon.
Mm-hmm. So on our next episode, we will start with Joseph, and start down that line. Very confusing line.
So
stay tuned.
On and stay tuned.
Drinking dog.